Detective Recapped here. Today, I'm going to explain a psychological thriller drama film called, We Need to Talk About Kevin. Beyond these genres, the movie stands as a quintessential horror piece. It confronts taboo fears that are only taboo because of how acutely human they are and picks them apart for a hopeless and futile search for answers. Spoilers ahead. Watch out and take care. Parents should love their children unconditionally. As the quote goes, a child needs your love most when he deserves it least. Mothers, as the bearers of these children and that mythical mother's instinct, are specifically burdened with this expectation. We say burden, because what if that mother has given birth to a monster? Should she give that monster all her loving, still? Should she keep examining herself for anything that might trace the monstrosity back to her? No matter what the answer is, you can't win, because an untamed monster will just be traced back to you. Eva Cachadorian knows this all too well. Throngs of people stained in red are gathered for the tomato-throwing festival in Spain. Carried by a group of these people is a blissful foreigner, Eva. Her arms spread as these strangers carry her. Soon, they set her on the ground, where she gets splashed in tomatoes. This eventually overwhelms her, and she starts covering her face while the loud cries from all around her ceaselessly go on. But that isn't the present. It's a distant past, and the reality is, Eva lives in an unkempt and worn-down home with a myriad of pills on the table. Waking up on her couch, she notices the loud red paint outside her window. Eva trudges out, and she sees that her walls, patio, and car are vandalized by striking red paint. Red was once the color of bliss for Eva as she dreamed of happier times in a foreign country. But with the color streaked all across her properties, it's become a color of hostility. The way her house and car were vandalized with no one alerting her implies that this is a deliberate attack against her. It must be no coincidence that the image of Eva being carried by the crowd resembles the crucifixion. Sins have been committed, and Eva is being punished and resented for it. The question is, what is the sin and who committed it? Eva stops by a travel agency. She wears sunglasses to hide her face while inside, and she only takes them off for the job interview. The boss goes through her extensive CV, and after commenting that Eva's done a lot, the woman tells her that she doesn't care who she is or what she's done as long as she can do the job. Eva feels a great sense of relief just hearing those words, and she thanks the woman profusely. She walks out of the travel agency with a smile, and she comes across two women she doesn't seem to know. Without warning, one of them socks her in the face. The furious woman snaps at Eva to rot in hell before walking away in tears. A man quickly approaches Eva and offers to call 911 for her, but Eva firmly insists that she's fine. No matter where Eva is, she looks and acts like a foreigner in that place. And she is, Eva clearly doesn't belong there. The travel agency may have hired her, but she's overqualified for it. With how a stranger approached her just to attack her, it feels like she hardly belongs out in public, either. But Eva solemnly accepts these misfortunes, just like she accepted that someone defaced her home. She's in an abnormal situation, and she's just trying to get by as normally as possible, even if it means squandering herself. Again, Eva remembers a fragment of her past. She's moving past a devastated crowd, and they're all bathed in the red emergency lighting. Something terrible had happened. Back to reality, Eva's home, and she lies wide awake. She thinks back to when she and her husband, Franklin, were much younger and happier. The two stumbled blissfully along the streets, intoxicated by God knows what in each other. Franklin's been telling her that he missed her especially since she's always away in a different country. When they made love, Franklin made her promise that she'll never go away again, and Eva did. Months passed and Eva was looking disdainfully at her pregnant body in the mirror. Meanwhile, Franklin had finished setting up the baby furniture. He's excited while Eva is unimpressed. Eva had a happy life with Franklin, but Eva's always happier elsewhere. She's a traveler, and she's not one to be bound to a single place. While pregnancies are usually depicted as exciting chapters in a woman's life, Eva seemed to think otherwise. That pregnancy became the anchor that bound her to a single place, and it distorted and limited her body in ways she wasn't used to or even happy about. Franklin appeared oblivious to all this, especially since it's natural and even expected for parents to be thrilled for their upcoming baby. But the worries, fears, and even dread that may come with parenthood are often overlooked, especially for mothers. One day in the present, Eva takes the afternoon off from her job to visit someone in prison. She sits blankly in the visiting room even when she's face to face with her son, Kevin. Like her, Kevin stays silent, but he almost looks like he's taunting her with the way he cuts his fingernails with his teeth and places the nails neatly on the table. After that fruitless visit, Eva starts to leave the prison while a resistant man is being apprehended by the cops. He keeps screaming for her and begging for her help, all while insisting that he never did anything wrong. This visit opens up the question, did Eva do anything wrong herself? Kevin was unmoved and unbothered while Eva stewed there in distress, discomfort, and hollowness. It's as if that even though Kevin's the one in prison, Eva's the one living the punishment. But that doesn't change the fact that Kevin is the one in jail, he did something. Despite Eva's unwavering silence, she must feel similar to that apprehended man screaming for help and insisting his innocence. In another memory, Eva's surrounded by pregnant women for a yoga session. They wore clothes that showed off their bellies, but not Eva. Her clothes were loose, and she looked like she didn't want to be there. When she was finally giving birth, the doctors kept telling her to stop resisting. Eva was a hollow shell afterwards. Her husband happily cradled her baby beside her, and she didn't even look. Time passed again, and Eva's with baby Kevin. He wouldn't stop crying no matter how much she tried to soothe him. Her smile was forced, and she could hardly maintain it. Eventually, she went to a construction site just to drown out the sounds of her baby crying. Later, Eva's finally asleep on the couch. She woke up when Franklin arrived, and he carried Kevin despite her protests. To her surprise, Kevin didn't cry, and Franklin happily told her she just had to rock him. "Stop resisting, Eva." Those were the doctor's words, and those were likely the words that Eva had to keep telling herself. Eva was the portrait of the dreadful, parental fear. What if you don't get that instant love, that instant connection with your child? What if being with your child doesn't make you happy? Eva's answer to the question was detachment and effort. The way she smiled needlessly at the unwitting and screaming newborn was so inauthentic, like she was just doing it because you're expected to smile at your baby. And for her to take Kevin to a busy construction site just to drown his cries out with something else spoke of her detachment to motherhood, the lapse in judgment she had by potentially risking Kevin's hearing. But she kept trying for Kevin, Franklin, and herself. Returning to the present, Eva's in a grocery store, and she recognizes a woman there. She hides from her, and when the coast is clear, she heads to the cashier. The cashier checks her carton of eggs, only to find all 12 of them broken. It's clear that Eva hid too late, and the woman already noticed her. Catching the woman's gaze, Eva rushes out of the grocery store, and she takes the broken eggs with her. Another memory comes to her, and there, she could see that same woman among the crowd, crying. Later, Eva eats the scrambled eggs, and she places the broken egg shells from her mouth neatly on the plate. Eggs are typically used to symbolize a woman's fertility, and by extension, her children. And these broken eggs may represent Eva's failure as a mother or her failed children. Either way, it hardly matters whose failure it was. It still haunts Eva even in her most mundane activities like eating, which is made clear by how she keeps having to remove egg shells from her mouth. At this point, the very act of breathing can remind Eva of that failure, that brokenness. In another flashback, Kevin's now a petulant and angry-looking toddler. Eva painstakingly rolled a ball to him, trying to get him to roll back, but he refused. She looked exhausted and impatient, but she hid it beneath a veneer of tolerance. Eva had a doctor check Kevin's hearing and for signs of autism, but the doctor said he's fine. The answer disappointed Eva, who kept forcing a smile. Back at home, Eva impatiently and frustratedly rolled the ball to Kevin, and to her relief, he finally rolled it back. But when Eva tried it again, Kevin didn't budge, and instead, he smirked at her. Sometime later, Eva tried to get Kevin to say mummy, but all Kevin had to say was no. Returning to the present, Eva visits Kevin in prison again. They still don't talk, and Kevin remains as nonchalant as ever. In Eva's fractured memories, something's wrong with Kevin. She couldn't trace it to a reason, and she was even disappointed to hear that he didn't have autism. If he did, then she'd at least have something to attribute his behavior to. Even from toddlerhood, Eva saw that Kevin was out to spite her. From the way he smirked when he refused to roll the ball a second time, showing that he could do it but just didn't want to, and to the way he kept saying no when she asked him to say mummy, she must be feeling that Kevin's on a crusade to torment her. This might not even be a new feeling for Eva, especially since she saw how baby Kevin always cried around her but quieted down when around Franklin. During Halloween, children are hounding Eva's house for candy. They bang on the door while Eva frantically searches for any sweets there to no avail. They won't stop calling out to her, banging on her door, and shining a light to her face. Overwhelmed, Eva slides down to the floor, and she remembers a series of events from her past again. Kevin kept throwing the food she prepared, saying he doesn't like it. In another time, she spitefully crooned at a very upset-looking Kevin that she was happy before he came along, and now she wakes up every day wishing she were in France. Franklin caught her doing that, and in disapproval, he walked away. Years passed, and Franklin told Eva they had to move to a more kid-friendly house, which Eva's vehemently against. Kevin kept babbling, so Frank gently patted his head to quiet down. When Kevin went at it again, Eva slapped his hand. It's not by chance that those memories are striking Eva now. Just as she's unable to give those kids the candy they want, she wasn't able to be the mother Kevin wanted or needed her to be. From the beginning, she's had a heavy heart towards her pregnancy, and that resentment kept seeping through even after Kevin was born. Franklin contrasts her with his ever-warm and loving treatment of their child. This isn't to say that Eva was cruel, but she's cold and definitely far less loving. And in a moment of frustration, she even admitted how unhappy Kevin made her and how trapped she was as his mother. In another one of Eva's flashbacks, Eva and her family moved into their new house. Eva had decorated her study with what she actually loved, maps and travel memorabilia. She was satisfied with her work until Kevin went in and said that it looked dumb. Forcing a smile, Eva offered to help him decorate his room to make it look more special and fit his personality. Kevin petulantly asked what personality, and the two were at a standstill until Eva had to answer a phone. When she came back, she found the entire room splattered with red and black paint with Kevin as the maestro. Furious, she took the paint gun and stomped on it repeatedly. That night, Franklin chided Kevin and told his wife that Kevin's sorry, he just wanted to make her room special. There could have been a multitude of reasons why Kevin defaced his mother's study. He could have resented the way Eva lit up around her maps and how she seemed happier surrounded by them than with him. Kevin might have vandalized her room like that because he thought that the Jackson Pollock-esque splashes of red and black suited his mother's personality much more. Or maybe, he could have just been a brat with bratty tendencies. No matter what his reason was, it didn't matter as much as the mark he left on Eva's study, the only place of solace she was to have in their house. With that mark, Eva, who used to have the world at her feet, had no escape from him. In the present, Eva's visiting Kevin again. As he caresses the surgical scar on his forearm, Eva asks if he remembers how he got that. Kevin says it was the most honest thing she's ever done. He starts talking about how owners stick cats' noses into their own crap to litter train them. They don't like the smell, so they use the box. Back to another flashback, Kevin was deliberately answering Eva's counting questions wrong before perfectly counting to 50 to show her that they're wasting each other's time. Irritated, Eva sarcastically made him add a bunch of numbers together since he thought he's so smart. In turn, Kevin deliberately crapped in his diaper. Eva was incredulous as she angrily changed him, asking if he's enjoying himself. At this point, neither Eva nor Kevin bothers to even hide the disdain they have for each other. Eva's not even impressed by her son's counting skills, she just sees it as another vehicle for him to spite her with. Instead of responding, Kevin just walked away and once again, he deliberately crapped himself to force Eva to change him a second time. That time, Eva's had enough, so she grabbed her son and threw him across the room, seeing him with his broken arm snapped her out of it. After taking him to the doctor, the two drove in silence until Eva slowly apologized. Kevin remained quiet and ran out of the car as soon as they got home, against Eva's protests. Concerned, Franklin asked what happened and to Eva's surprise, Kevin told him that he fell off his changing station. Composing herself, Eva said that it's her fault, but Franklin embraced her, assuring her that she couldn't be watching him every second. That night, Eva tried telling Franklin what happened, but they got interrupted by the sound of Kevin flushing. Ecstatic, Franklin asked her how she finally managed to potty train him. Hurting Kevin was a rare moment of outburst from Eva. She let that facade of care and tolerance go, and she showed Kevin how she really felt about him. It's natural for people to have those who they hate, but what about parents? What if a parent can only love their child but not like them? That's the conundrum that Eva's been living with for as long as Kevin's been breathing. She may have loved her child, but she didn't like Kevin. After all, if she didn't love him as her own, she would have never tried. But somehow, Kevin saw right through her facade and even as a teenager, he acknowledges what would have been a traumatic moment for most children as a moment of rare honesty between him and his mother. Meanwhile, Franklin's just content with his family, and he remained oblivious to his wife's plights. Later that night, Eva visited Kevin in his room. The boy just glared at her, and when Eva tenderly kissed him and told him she loved him, Kevin just did his baby babble to dismiss her. Eva felt defeated, and she walked away while Kevin bitterly watched her leave. Maybe Kevin wished she tried more or do more to make him feel that she did love him. Maybe he saw her gestures as dishonest and performative or something he can do away with. But Kevin had his walls, and Eva didn't try to push them. Still in another one of Eva's memories, she's in a car with Kevin. She was walking on eggshells around the boy, and with a restrained voice, she asked if they could stop by a store. Kevin boredly said he wanted to go home. When she glanced at Kevin, she saw him picking at his scar, so Eva bit back her protests and agreed to go. Days passed in the flashback, and Kevin openly made a mess in front of Eva, all while looking at her defiantly. But when Franklin arrived, Kevin changed his tune to a sweet and happy one. He greeted his dad like an angel, while a seething Eva silently mocked his speaking. Later, Eva was laying her head on Franklin's lap while he softly assured her that Kevin's just a sweet boy and that's what boys do. Some say that when you blindly trust someone and you never stop to doubt them, it means that you've given up on understanding them. This speaks to the way Franklin handled Kevin. He was always a positive force in his life. He's the cool dad who never really punished him or saw past the angelic act Kevin had for him. It seemed that Franklin never tried to understand Eva and Kevin or their relationship, so everything was left unchecked between the mother and son. Then again, these flashbacks are all pieces from Eva's own memories. And in her alienation, she keeps trying to make sense of what happened, and she keeps trying to find reason. It's unclear how reliable of a narrator she is, and if Kevin was really manipulating her with his scar, if he was really trying to spite her, or if Eva just saw things that way. But one thing's for certain, while Kevin showed his dad that he adored him to bits, he consistently displayed antagonistic behavior towards Eva. Time passed in the flashback, and Kevin called Eva fat. That was when Franklin realized that Eva was pregnant. Eva later tried to explain her pregnancy to Kevin, and he crudely interrupted her to ask if she's talking about screwing, which he proceeded to explain to her. Softly, Eva tried easing up Kevin to her pregnancy, saying that he might like having a sibling. When Kevin asked what if he didn't like it, Eva knowingly told him that he'll get used to it. In response, Kevin said that just because you're used to something, doesn't mean you like it. While breaking his crayons, he added that Eva's used to him. Even if Eva understood her son's implications, she just told him that in a few months, they're all going to get used to someone new. This was such a brief interaction, but it showed just how detached and disconnected Eva was to Kevin. She didn't even try to assure her son that she does like him and that he's not just a responsibility or a burden for her to bear. All Eva could do was sit there and tell Kevin everything else except that he was wrong. But in a way, this showed just how alike Eva and Kevin were. There's a cold honesty to the both of them, a certain harshness. While Kevin openly displayed his antagonism towards Eva, Eva implicitly and explicitly admitted how she felt towards Kevin. Regardless, Eva was wrong. She didn't just get used to her newborn daughter, Celia. She actually liked her. With contempt, Kevin watched her cradle and coo at the baby before approaching them to sprinkle water at Celia's face. Eva immediately stopped him, and Kevin just stared at her before Franklin took him down for some snacks. Back to the present, Eva is walking along the dark streets of her town. She remembers Frank incredulously asking her why she has to go to Ecuador for 2 months. He brought up her complaints about Kevin crying too much, Kevin being too quiet, Kevin making up his own language, and Kevin not being toilet trained. Finally, he emphasized how she thought that all of those were a personal vendetta against her and how it's not good for Kevin to have her thinking that way. When Eva was pregnant, she resented the notion of motherhood, but at that point, it was just that, a notion. But with Kevin born, she actually had someone to direct those emotions to, a specific source of bereftness and imprisonment. Eva must have realized that Kevin shared an extreme likeness with her, and she could have been worried that with Kevin understanding her resentment, he's throwing it all back to her by tormenting her. After all, children tend to be projections of their parents. In another flashback, Kevin's sick and lying on the floor. Concerned, Eva picked him up and took care of him. All the while, Kevin weakly told her that he's sorry, so Eva held his hand, assuring him not to worry. That night, Eva read Kevin the story of Robin Hood, and when she started describing him shooting his bow, Kevin snuggled up closer to her, much to her surprise. When Franklin came in to check on Kevin, he told him to go away and asked his mom to keep reading. This took both parents aback, but the joy in Eva's face was clear as day. She continued reading to him, stroking his hair, and kissing his head while Kevin didn't resist her touch. He even leaned closer. Back to the present, Eva paints a room in her house blue. It's the same blue in Kevin's childhood room. After many years of back and forths, that was the first time Kevin and Eva were shown to enjoy tender moments with each other. And even after everything that happened, it looked like Eva was preparing a place for Kevin in her home. It was ironic. With Kevin much too sick and vulnerable for the world, he sought the care of his mother, showing that in the end, that's who Eva is to him. Likewise, with Eva's isolation, she only had Kevin, and her ties with him couldn't be diminished. Again, Eva thinks back to her past. She warmly tried to help Kevin get dressed, but Kevin was back to being cross and dismissively hostile towards her. Eva understood this and left. As always, when Eva saw Kevin with his walls, she'd abandon any attempt at reaching out to him. Franklin had given Kevin an archery set, and the boy sweetly thankful to him. He had a way of hitting his targets, and that hobby carried over to his teenhood. Kevin hadn't changed much, he was still doing archery and he was still wearing his shirts from when he was a kid. In the present, Eva wakes up to Kevin speaking on TV, talking about how all anyone occupies themselves with these days is watching TV. He knows that everyone likes watching people like him, and he even comments that they'd have turned the channel if all he did was get an A in geometry. This only highlights how similar Kevin and Eva are to each other. Like his mother who never liked staying in one place, Kevin rejected mundanity. He knew that a listless life isn't for him, and with how he cemented himself as the kind of person that people like to watch, he did exactly what Eva sought in her life, which was something exceptional and unmundane. And ultimately, he condemned his mother by making her world as small as it can be by stripping her of her identity as Eva and reducing her into his mother, the mother of a criminal. Another flashback comes. With the bathroom door left ajar, Eva opened it to find Kevin pleasuring himself. Instead of stopping, Kevin just looked at her and held her gaze with a sinister expression, even pleasuring himself more furiously. Eva quickly closed the door. In present time, Eva attends her office Christmas party. Her co-worker, Colin, who's been quite nice to her, asks her for a dance. When Eva politely refuses, Colin leans in to call her stuck up, then asks if she thinks anyone's going to want her. The enjoyment on Eva's face quickly drains, and she leaves. Flashing back, Eva was happily walking with Celia along the streets and humming nonsense tunes with her. Eva's interactions with Celia shows that she has it in her to be a good and loving mother, that she's capable of seeming content with motherhood and she can make that instant maternal connection with her child. Suddenly, Celia stopped and excitedly pointed at Kevin across the street. When Eva looked, Kevin was staring at a poster of Eva in a bookstore which called her a legendary adventurer. But a car passed, and Kevin was no longer there. At home, Eva asked if Kevin was at the bookstore that day, and after a pause, Kevin lied that he wasn't. The two never looked at each other, and Eva eventually invited him for golf and dinner that Friday. Despite the awkward tension between them, Kevin surprisingly agreed. Friday came, and it was golfing time. Eva made a comment about fat people eating all the time, and Kevin noted that she was kind of harsh. Incredulous, Eva retorted that he's one to talk, and Kevin responded that he wonders where he got it from. After golfing, Eva told Kevin to get changed so she can take him to dinner. At home, Eva caught Kevin scarfing down a whole chicken. This seems to be a common theme in Eva's life, she'd get her hopes up only to get disappointed, and fast. When she thought that she was actually making a friend in Colin at work, he went and insulted her for not dancing with him. When she'd think she chipped at Kevin's walls, he'd raise them back up. Now, when she thought that she can have a good time with her son, he openly spited her again by eating plentifully before their dinner. And just as Eva had anticipated, Kevin didn't order anything in the restaurant. Eva tried to ask him about school, but Kevin cut her off and asked all the questions she likely planned on asking, from bands, to girls, to drugs. Then, he went on and talked about how she'll squeeze his shoulder and tell him how nice it was to spend time together. Eva didn't say anything after that. This is yet another instance of Eva yielding to Kevin, of her not proving him wrong, and her not trying beyond her first attempt at reaching out to him. Clearly, not much has changed since Kevin told her she was just used to him. After everything that's happened between the two of them, it becomes evident that Eva isn't someone who can love unconditionally. And this is a taboo notion to even consider because parents, mothers especially, are expected to love their children unconditionally. She showered Celia with love and care because she had no problem accepting it and reciprocating. Meanwhile, Kevin hardly ever proved himself to be deserving of love, so Eva, try as she may to pretend, could never be fond of him. Then again, Kevin was never unconditional to his parents, either. Looking at Kevin might just be like looking at a mirror for Eva. Christmas came, and Kevin got a proper bow and arrow from Franklin. Celia later lost her pet hamster, and she was extremely upset. The next day, Eva was consoling Celia when she realized that their drain was clogged. Looking at the blockage, Eva let out a repulsed groan before looking out the window to look at a smiling Kevin playing ball with his dad. He stopped smiling when he noticed Eva watching him, and with a look of disbelief, Eva brought out the drain cleaner. Time passed, and Eva and Franklin were dreadfully waiting at a hospital. After some terse silence, Franklin frustratedly asked her why she left the drain cleaner out, and Eva insisted that she put it away. With a faltering voice, she added that Kevin did it. In turn, Franklin told her she needs to talk to someone before walking away. The older Kevin got, the more apparent to Eva that her boy was something of a monster. He was a walking hazard sign that no one else but her seemed to recognize. It's impossible to know whether Kevin took out the drain cleaner to trigger Celia's accident or if Eva really just left it in the counter. Either way, Franklin could have been the one to talk to Eva. They could have addressed the issue head on, he could have listened to her more, and maybe, just maybe, Kevin could have grown up differently. But it's just as likely that who Kevin is was completely out of their depths. Over breakfast, Franklin tried to remind Kevin that what happened to Celia wasn't his fault, and when Kevin asked him why he'd feel that way, Eva snapped that he was supposed to look after her. Days passed, and Eva and Franklin were watching TV with Celia, who now had to wear a glass eye. When Kevin passed by to ask if Celia wanted to pick up his arrows, Eva immediately shouted no. Disappointed, Franklin walked away. The rift between Eva and Franklin grew, and they ended up talking about divorce. Franklin bitterly mentioned that at least custody was a no-brainer, and Eva challenged him, asking if it was. Franklin just told her there was nothing left to decide. When Kevin cleared his throat, Eva and Franklin realized he was listening. Though Franklin tried to say that it's easy to misunderstand things when you don't have the context, Kevin said that he was the context. The debate between nature and nurture is inescapable when it comes to troubled individuals. But when you're responsible for that person, this debate falls short of importance, and what you have to do is come up with a solution, a response, and that's precisely what Eva and Franklin never did. Kevin may be the context, but they never truly talked about him. They never took the necessary steps to really assess him and help him out. All they had was a superficial answer to a deep problem. More time passed, and while Franklin's happily dancing with Celia, Kevin was staring blankly ahead. Eva felt his forehead and commented on how clammy he felt, and Kevin blankly told her he's never felt better. Kevin maintained an unreadable expression as Eva mentioned that he's turning 16 in 3 days before asking if he wanted to do something on Sunday. Noncommittally, Kevin answered he might be tied up. That was the most openly distant Kevin's been. Despite his facade of cool, Eva could tell that he was looking clammy. But of course, Kevin just kept her at an arm's length. When Kevin went to school that day, he headed straight for the gym. After sealing the doors with bike locks, he started preparing his bow and arrows. Meanwhile, Eva was at her office, listening to the voicemail she left Franklin about wanting to fix their marriage. Suddenly, her coworker came in and urgently asked about Kevin's high school. Eva rushed to the school, and there, she moved past a devastated crowd in search of her son. Immediately after the locks were broken, they opened the door to reveal Kevin casually making his way out. He looked around the crowd as if they were his adoring fans, and without resistance, he got down on the ground. Eva could only watch on in horror, and when the cops started cuffing Kevin, he even smiled at his mother. Life as Eva knew it came to a standstill. That must have been her worst fears coming true, but this was also the affirmation of her paranoia, the proof that her fear, wariness, and even contempt towards Kevin were never unfounded. In the present, Eva lies wide awake, and she imagines how Kevin shot all those innocent teenagers one by one. Finally, she thought back to going home in an utter daze that night. How she looked for Franklin and Celia in her home, and how she found the two of them dead in their backyard. There were two arrows in Franklin and one in Celia. Eva could picture Kevin bowing in the gym, as if he'd put on the greatest performance of his life. At this point, Eva's done stewing over everything that had happened. She smells her Led Zeppelin shirt, which once belonged to her late husband, and cries. Then, she irons Kevin's shirts, kept them in the blue painted room in her house, and placed his Robin Hood book there. Monday comes, and she visits Kevin. This time, however, the infallible image of Kevin is gone, his head shaved, face cut with wounds. Instead of the sharp and self-assured visage he always wore, Kevin looked shaken up, vulnerable. Prison must have been increasingly hard for him, and it must have shown him how big the world was outside his own, that he wasn't the unconquerable monster that the living thought him to be. Finally, Eva speaks, saying that he doesn't look happy. Kevin asks if he's ever looked happy before saying that he's almost 18. Eva surmises that going to the adult prison was making him nervous, and Kevin incredulously asks if she knows anything about those places. With restraint, Eva muses about how he's managed it all so well, being tried as a minor and being out of his head on Prozac. She also adds that he'll be out in a couple of years. Finally, Eva asks him the big question. Why? Kevin doesn't say anything at first. Instead, he looks lost, but eventually, he manages to tell her that he used to think he knew. Now, he isn't sure. The entire time, Eva's done nothing but live in the wake of her son's crime. She's been a ghost, unable to stay in the present and ceaselessly traveled through her memories trying to find out why. Why did Kevin do this? Was it her fault? Was it purely Kevin's? Was there even a reason to any of this, to all her suffering and her desolation? Even after all this time, life had a way of never meeting Eva's hopes, and until the very end, she's left with nothing. Silence falls between them, and just as Kevin opens his mouth to speak, the guard tells him that his time's up. Kevin immediately stands up, and he almost looks scared as he just stares at Eva. Wordlessly, Eva suddenly embraces her son, who just stares ahead, trembling while Eva holds his head. After their meeting, Eva looks adrift as she walks out into the light. Some may say that the horror lies in watching a deviously smart and sinister child grow up into something uncontrollable and recognizable only to you. To have people deaf to your cries that the very child you birthed, fed, and clothed bears the flowers of evil. It could also be the cruel and pitiable way that a mother's forced to live in the aftermath of her son's massacre, making life not hell for her, but a limbo that strips her of any connection with everyone but the very son who made her a pariah for the bereaved to condemn. But most of all, the horror lies in Eva being left to endlessly wonder if she's responsible for the way Kevin is, if she, by proxy, had killed all those students. It lies in the way she keeps tracing Kevin's killings back to herself and the way she substitutes grief with guilt and the fear of responsibility. And it's pretty damn horrific that after returning to square one and seeing that Kevin no longer has an answer to her question, Eva walks away into the light as if fully realizing and accepting that this is her life now, and her life will always be bound to Kevin's. Underneath all the horror, though, is still something painfully human. During that final visit, Kevin had receded to the sick and vulnerable boy he used to be, the one who let his mother touch him and comfort him. After years of resenting her, Kevin let his hubris, his misanthrope collapse, and he finally understands that he needs his mother. At his core, Kevin's just a teenager. A vile, twisted, and disturbed teenager, but a teenager, nonetheless. In turn, Eva receded to the very thing she's been averse to, being Kevin's mother. Against reason and against all that he's done, Eva's willing to accept Kevin. She's willing, or forced, to keep loving him and giving him a place in her home and in her life. After all, what's a more quintessential show of motherhood than to unconditionally welcome your child back in your arms, even after they've gone astray? Subscribe to watch more videos like this. Turn on notifications. And leave a like, it really helps the channel out. Thank you for watching.